Welcome back, students. This is the third lecture on the chapter of ultrasonics. We were in the process of discussing about how to produce ultrasonic waves. We have already studied one method of producing ultrasonic waves, that's the magnetostriction method, wherein a ferromagnetic rod placed inside a solenoid to which a AC signal is applied vibrates at the desired frequency to produce ultrasonic waves. So that's the magnetostriction method, but it had a limitation. We had seen we cannot reduce the length of the rod to a very small size. So because of that, the maximum frequency you can generate ultrasonic waves by this method is something around 100 kilohertz. So if you want ultrasonic waves above 100 kilohertz, suppose you want 1 megahertz or 2 megahertz frequency ultrasonic waves, we have to use a different method. Okay, and so that's the piezoelectric method of producing ultrasonic waves, and this is the most common method. Because it is a relatively easier, cheaper method, the circuit is less complicated, the materials required are less expensive, it is more compact. Okay, so this is a more preferred method of producing ultrasonic waves compared to magnetostriction. So to understand this method, first we have to know what is this phenomena of piezoelectricity, piezoelectric effect. What is this piezoelectric effect? So in piezoelectric effect, there are two phenomena. One is called as a direct piezoelectric effect, and another one is called the inverse piezoelectric effect. So it is important to know these two phenomena thoroughly before we proceed to produce ultrasonic waves using this piezoelectric method. So let us try to understand these two phenomena: direct piezoelectric effect and inverse piezoelectric effect. So what is this direct piezoelectric effect? What is piezoelectric effect? There are certain types of crystals, certain types of materials called as piezoelectric materials. The most common examples of this are quartz, rock salt, tourmaline, Rochelle salt. So these are some piezoelectric materials which, when you subject to mechanical pressure, suppose this is a piezoelectric material, this is a material, let us say, of quartz. Quartz is the most commonly used piezoelectric material. There are other materials also like PZT, lead zirconium titanate, which is also a common piezoelectric material. So any piezoelectric material, let us say, we take it and we compress it. Okay, we apply pressure to it, we press it. What happens is that a charge appears on this material. Okay, on this surfaces, charges appear. One side becomes positively charged, other side surface becomes negatively charged. So when you compress, when you apply a mechanical pressure to the crystal, a charge is developed, a potential difference is developed across the surfaces of the crystal. So this phenomena is called as direct piezoelectric effect. So we can basically view this piezoelectric effect as a energy conversion from mechanical to electrical. So you are applying mechanical energy in the form of pressure applied to the crystal. What is generated is a voltage. So if you connect a voltmeter across these two faces of the crystal, it will show you a reading of voltage. More you press the crystal, higher will be the value of the voltage generated. So the magnitude of the voltage charge which is generated depends upon the strength of the mechanical force which you apply. One more important thing is that if you reverse the direction of the force, so instead of pressing, suppose you try to stretch the crystal, pull it apart, then the polarity of the voltage developed will be opposite. Suppose this side is with pressing the crystal, suppose upper surface becomes positive and negative. When you stretch the crystal, upper surface will become negative, lower surface will become positive. So in this, if the polarity is plus minus, for the other way force applied, the polarity will be minus plus. Okay, so depending upon whether you apply a compressive force or an extensive force across the piezoelectric material, the polarity of the voltage which is developed also changes. So this is the main important phenomena called as the direct piezoelectric effect. So what is happening here? Mechanical pressure or mechanical energy is being converted into electrical energy. Polarity depends on whether the pressure is compressive elongative. So if you compress the crystal, polarity is 1 plus minus. If you elongate the crystal, polarity might be opposite, minus plus. Okay. So this is about direct piezoelectric effect. We find applications of this phenomena in many day-to-day applications, like for example a lighter, gas lighter. It works on the principle of piezoelectric effect. When you press the button of a lighter, there is a spring-loaded hammer which goes and falls against the piezoelectric crystal. So the hammer goes and falls on this with a large force. So since the force is very large, a very high voltage is generated by that crystal, and this voltage is brought very close by two wires, and a spark is created over there. Okay, just like the ignition of your spark plug in a vehicle. Similar way, when a high voltage is created by the crystal and is brought very close within a small gap, a spark is created, and that is what is used for lighting the gas lighter. Now this phenomenon also used for mics, microphones, loudspeakers. Okay, so you will find these things in small microphones of your mobile, which are very tiny, so very compact. Even small loudspeakers make use of this piezoelectric materials for producing ultrasonic waves, generation of the sound. Okay, so only certain materials which I told you, okay, quartz, rock salt, tourmaline, lead, zirconium, titanium, these materials are called as piezoelectric materials. So only these materials show this phenomena. When you apply pressure, they produce a voltage. Now what is the inverse piezoelectric effect? Now this is important for us for the generation of ultrasonic waves. Inverse is just the opposite. In inverse piezoelectric effect, what you are going to do is, you are going to apply a voltage. Okay? Suppose you apply take a battery and you connect it across the two faces of a piezoelectric material. What happens? The piezoelectric material either gets compressed, okay, either gets compressed or it gets elongated. It either decreases in size or increases in size on its own because of the applied voltage. So here what is happening? Electrical energy which you are supplying in the form of the voltage gets converted into mechanical displacement. So electrical energy is converted into mechanical energy. Here, mechanical energy was converted into electrical energy. Here, in inverse effect, it's just the opposite. You are applying the electrical energy in the form of the voltage to the crystal. The crystal either gets compressed or stretches on its own. So this is called as the inverse piezoelectric effect. Now, whether the crystal will contract or expand, what does it depend upon? You must have guessed it. It depends upon the polarity of the applied voltage. So suppose plus is this side and minus is this side. Let us say the crystal compresses, becomes smaller in size. If you reverse the polarity, minus plus, the crystal will increase in size, it will expand. Okay. So depending upon the polarity of the applied voltage, you can change whether the crystal contracts or expands. So this is called as the inverse piezoelectric effect, and this phenomena is what is used for the production of ultrasonic waves. So we are going to see now how to produce ultrasonic waves based on this inverse piezoelectric effect. So use of inverse piezoelectric effect to generate ultrasonic waves. So suppose we have, let us say, a piezoelectric crystal. Okay, let us say a quartz crystal. And to this crystal, suppose we apply we had applied a DC signal. So instead of applying a DC signal, suppose we apply a AC signal to it. Okay. Suppose we apply AC signal to this quartz crystal. What is going to happen? AC signal, as we have seen earlier, it has a positive cycle and a negative cycle. So during the positive cycle, what is going to happen? Let us say this side is plus, this side is minus, and the current flows in this direction. So what will happen? You are applying positive and negative, plus minus, to the crystal in that direction. So let us say in this orientation of the voltage, the crystal expands, becomes bigger in size. What will happen in the negative cycle then? Negative cycle, the polarity will reverse. The polarity will reverse and it will become minus plus. Polarity will reverse and the voltage will become minus plus. What will happen in this case? So the crystal will contract. So if in the positive cycle the crystal expands because the polarity is plus minus, in the negative cycle since the polarity has reversed, the crystal will contract. So this will happen in every cycle. So in the positive cycle the crystal will become bigger inside, in the negative cycle the crystal will become smaller inside. Then again in the next cycle, positive will become bigger, negative will become smaller. And that will continue as long as the AC signal is present applied across the quartz crystal. So remember what you see. So again if I label this point in the AC cycle as A, B, C, D and E. What happens at point A? At point A, where the signal value is 0, this is the 0 line of the signal. Signal value is 0, so no voltage. So the crystal is unchanged in length, original length. The crystal is at its original length, unchanged length. Now at point B, what happens? From A to B, what happens to the value? The signal value is increasing in positive direction. So the crystal, let us say, increases in size. At point B, the crystal will become maximum in size. Then from point B to C, the crystal is again decreasing in length. Why? Because the value of the signal is decreasing. The voltage applied is decreasing. So the crystal also decreases. And at point C where the signal value is 0, the crystal will come back to its original length, unchanged length. Then from C to D, what is happening now? The polarity of the voltage is reversing. Reverse direction. So what is going to happen? The crystal will contract. So from C to D, the crystal will become smaller in size, and at point B, the crystal will become minimum in size. Please note that if the crystal is not going to increase from C to D, it's going to decrease. Why? Because the polarity, that's a phenomenon which happens in piezoelectric effect. If you reverse the polarity, the crystal which earlier had expanded, now it contracts. Okay, it becomes smaller in size. So at point D, where the signal value is minimum, is maximum negative, the crystal will become smallest in size. Then from D to E, the signal is again going towards back to 0. So the crystal will again start increasing in size, and at point E, the crystal will come back to its original length, since at point E, the signal value is 0. So this is what happens to the crystal in one full cycle of the AC signal. So how many vibrations is that? What is the meaning of a vibration? Suppose you start from original length. At point A, the signal is starting with its original length. At point B, it is becoming going out. At point C, it came back to its original length. At point D, it again still goes smaller, it goes in. And then at point E, it comes back to its original length. So now this is just one vibration. Original, maximum, then in and back to original. So that's just one cycle. Starting from original, you went to maximum, came back to original, reduced and came back to original. So that's just one in and out motion. There are no two in and out motions there. It's just out and then back to in. So in one cycle of the AC signal, there is only one vibration. So one cycle there is only one vibration. Unlike the magnetosuction method, in one cycle there were two vibrations. In piezoelectric method, in one cycle, there is only one out and in motion, only one vibration. So therefore, if we apply a signal of frequency f over here, the quartz crystal will also vibrate at the same frequency f. One cycle, one vibration. So f cycles, f vibrations. Okay? So if the frequency which is applied is anything more than 20,000 Hertz, this will also be greater than or equal to 20,000 Hertz. Hence, the quartz crystal is going to vibrate at the same frequency which you are applying, and it will produce ultrasonic waves of that frequency. Okay. So, what is the object which is vibrating here therefore? It is the quartz crystal which is vibrating and producing the ultrasonic waves. In the magnetosuction method, it was the ferromagnetic rod which was vibrating and producing the ultrasonic waves. Now, the same thing applies here also. The formula for the condition of resonance and large amplitude ultrasonic waves to generate them, you have to make the quartz crystal to vibrate at its resonance frequency. Only then the ultrasonic waves which are produced by this rod, by this crystal, will be of large amplitude. So the phenomena, the condition of resonance applies here also. What is the formula for natural frequency of the crystal? It is the same as what we had for the rod, with a slight modification, 1 upon 2 t root of y by rho. Here t is the thickness of the crystal. Okay, the thickness of the crystal. Y is the Young's modulus of the material of the crystal, and rho is the density of the material of the crystal. So now you see over here, this t, this crystal which is there, you can make it very thin. You can take a very thin slice of the quartz crystal, okay, and you can place it between the AC signal. So this crystal here can be made very thin. T is the thickness. So if t is very small, Fn can be made very large. Okay, so therefore, using this piezoelectric method, you can produce ultrasonic waves of large frequency. So why? Because the crystal can be made very thin. So smaller the value of t, higher is the value of Fn. So even up to 10 megahertz, you can generate ultrasonic waves using this piezoelectric method. Why? Because the crystal can be made very thin. So again, there's an oscillator circuit, there's a piezoelectric oscillator circuit to generate AC signals which you require to apply to your crystal. Okay, so you can see here the quartz crystal is there over here. So whatever other than the quartz crystal you see there is your oscillator circuit. It's an electronic circuit which is required to produce AC signals of whatever desired frequency you want. So again, this circuit over here consists of three parts, you can say. So the first part is the first part here is the heart of the circuit, just like in the previous case. This part here is the tank circuit. This is the part which actually generates the tank circuit. This is the part which generates the AC signals. Small AC signals will be produced by this circuit. Moment you switch on this DC power supply, this tank circuit will start producing small AC signals. Okay. Now these AC signals, you cannot directly apply them to your quartz crystal because they are very small in value. You have to increase their size. So through this path over here, the signals are given to the amplifier. So this part over here is your amplifier circuit. Transistor T acts as an amplifier there. So again, the small AC signal generated by this LC tank circuit is given to the input of the transistor amplifier. The transistor amplifier at the collector is the output of the amplifier. So at the collector, we have a large sine wave, high amplitude sine wave. And this then is given to the to this path, it is then given to the quartz crystal. So large AC signal is applied across the quartz crystal, and the frequency of the AC signal is adjusted using this variable capacitor C3. Okay, using this capacitor C3, we can adjust the frequency of this tank circuit to be how much? The frequency of the circuit should be equal to Fn, not Fn by 2. Why? Because in the case of a piezoelectric oscillator, whatever signal frequency you apply, the same signal frequency ultrasonic waves are generated. So suppose for a particular application you require ultrasonic waves of, let us say, 500 kilohertz, then this frequency of this AC oscillator, this circuit, has to be adjusted also to exactly 500 kilohertz. So how do you do the adjustment? Using the variable capacitor C3. So for example, suppose the crystal's frequency is 500 kilohertz. How are you going to design the circuit? Using this formula, Fn is equal to 1 upon 2t root of y upon rho. So suppose you're using a quartz material, a quartz crystal, where values of y and rho are known to you. So suppose you want 500 kilohertz as your frequency required for a particular application. In this formula, you put Fn as 500 kilohertz and calculate the value of t. T thickness. So then you take a thin slice of that thickness of the quartz crystal and you place it between this metal plates A and B. So A and B over here are two metal plates between which the slice of the crystal is sandwiched. So then you adjust the frequency of this circuit to be also exactly 500 kilohertz so that the AC signal generated will be of 500 kilohertz frequency. So the crystal will vibrate at 500 kilohertz and will produce ultrasonic waves of large amplitude having a frequency 500 kilohertz. So this is the way by which you can design and generate any signal frequency you want, anything above 100 kilohertz if you want, can generate using the piezoelectric method. So with this we end the first part of this chapter wherein we have talked about producing ultrasonic waves. So we have talked about magnetostriction method and piezoelectric method. Less than 100 kilohertz we use magnetostriction method because it is more efficient. Higher than 100 kilohertz we use the piezoelectric method because it is more efficient and it is more compact, it is more cheaper to use compared to magnetostriction method.